First of all, on International Women's Day, I would like to start by saying that I'm really proud of the female peacekeepers all over the world, the ones who've done it, the ones who are going to do it again, and the ones who are out there. I'm really proud of my friends over here, my sisters, as we call each other in the mission. These sisters are from Fiji, South Korea, and Indonesia. And these women are strong. They are tough cookies. They never complain. Do you think that if they feel weak, that they admit they feel weak? Or if they feel sick, that they do go to the company commander and tell them, hey, I feel not so good today. Can I maybe, you know, do something else than being there up there in the watchtower? They will never do that. They will never do that. These women, they don't complain because that is not accepted. They don't want to be seen as weak. They want to be seen as strong as their male colleagues, who are never sick, of course. Okay, but we need more of these women. We need more women in the military, and we need more female peacekeepers. But how are we going to get them? It's really not an easy thing to solve. We don't know yet how we get there. We can work with target numbers. I personally believe it does have an effect, but you know, you have also people who are against it. I am not going to talk about target numbers, but I would like to share some ideas, some beliefs that I have. For example, what I really believe in is in role models. For example, Deirdre here, she is a role model. She's even a role model for me. The way she speaks, the way the knowledge you have about gender, about the operations, the way you have thought about it, the way you bring your message across, so strong. You're a role model for many of your female colleagues, not only in the Irish Armed Forces, but also in the international, on an international platform. So role models are really important always, but also in the military. And I believe we can do more with the role models. And there's something else I think we should do as well. We women, we also have a task to support each other. Always, we should support each other. It's not only in the military, it's because I see people reacting to this, it's not only in the military, but also in the military, we should do this. Listen to each other, support each other, motivate each other. And telling a female colleague who's going to be deployed that she's not a bad mom, that she's leaving her children behind for a couple of months. No, she isn't. These children are going to be taken care of by others. It's just a way of, I think, really that comrade feeling is really important. So that supportive role, we should improve. I think that is key that we all should do in this world as women, but also in the military. Okay, there's something else I really believe in. And that's a new initiative of UN Women, and it's an all-female pre-deployment course. It's called the Female Military Officers Course. Here we go. What do you think the men say? Oh, this pre-deployment course, it's held in Beijing. Why can't I participate? And I'm saying, sorry, guys. You have all-male courses all the time. The only difference is it's not written in the title. But why do I support these initiatives? Because really, in the armed forces, we are rarely in a room with only female military women, where we can share our own experiences. And of course, normally we do that with the men and the women together, and that's what we should do most of the time. But when we are together with only women, we discuss things in a different way. And that is needed as well, because we are in a minority group, and that's what it is. So what we see, three times a year, I'm an instructor in this course, three times a year we bring together 40 women per class, they come from at least 25 nations. And these women feel empowered after these 2 weeks. We give them extra assets to be stronger in the mission, to even do a better job. And also, this gives them the opportunity to build up a network, an international network of female peacekeepers. And that really empowers them. Okay, this is about numbers. It's not all about numbers, because women, yes, we need more women, but what we also need, and especially need, is integrating the gender perspective into the operations. We need to look at the world with our gender glasses on, and that's what we need to teach our troops. So, here, the gender advisors come in. The important role of the gender advisor is to make the troops aware, the commanders aware, the force commander, the mission leadership. All the people in the missions should understand why it's important to integrate the gender perspective into the operations. That means whatever you do, whatever you plan, you always have to ask yourself the question, what does that mean for the men, the women, the boys and the girls? What needs do these people have? Are the needs of the women the same as the men? Sometimes it is, but often it isn't. So respond differently to their needs. That is what we teach the troops. We teach the troops to see power differences. Where is the power in this society? And what does that mean? What kind of effects does that have? So that is needed. The gender advisors do a lots of training. But what they also do is they work with the leadership, and they have to convince them to work to integrate the gender perspective into the daily work. So that it's not a fact of, okay, gender is being taken care of by the gender advisor, throw it in her office and she will do the work and we have done it. No, it's a responsibility of all of us. Another task, what gender advisors often do, they build up a network with the local women in the community, together with civil affairs and the CIMIC teams, so the civil military cooperation teams. Another task gender advisors have, in my opinion, but often they don't even have that much time for it, is that they can also support the women within the mission, so their own female peacekeepers. Here the support role comes back. So, the military gender advisors. Now we go into practice. Let me take you to 2009. I went to Afghanistan for the second time, but this time as the first military gender advisor in the operation in Afghanistan called ISAF in the headquarters in Kabul. I arrived there, entered the headquarters, and I said, "Hello, I'm Ella, I'm from the Dutch Armed Forces, and I am the gender advisor." "You are the what?" "I am the gender advisor." Well, that was almost, I was there for 5 months, almost every day, and I'm not lying, I had to explain at least 10 times what I was doing. Because by that time, 2009, gender was still quite new in the military. And people were not trained in gender, so I couldn't blame them. So I kept on smiling, explaining all the time what a gender advisor was doing. Not only concerned about where the female toilets are and where the male toilets are. And sometimes I needed to explain them that I was actually peeing in front of the tent, because if I had to walk all the way through the night, in the night, pitch dark on the camp, to the female toilets, I think I wouldn't have reached it with dry pajamas, because often they change the code of the lock, the code of the lock, because of course the female toilets had to be locked, but the male toilets didn't have to be locked. These things, with the best intentions, they did that for us, but sometimes not with the best results for us. So we were all peeing either behind the tent or in front of the tent. Okay, so 2009, so I had to explain all the time, gender is this, and yeah, we have to do this, and so they didn't really understand what it was all about. But who did understand what it was all about? The Afghan women. I got in contact with so many Afghan women, local women's organizations, and they said, finally, finally, sorry, but you are 7 years already here. I see all these military troops here. And after 7 years, there's finally somebody, especially for us, in your mission. That was their reaction. And they really understood what gender was all about. They were dying to be heard. They were trying to get me, invite them to the base, which we thought it was impossible, or not safe and secure for them. But is it on us to tell them what is safe and secure for them? If they want to come to the base, it's their choice and we should support them. So working with these Afghan women was for me so rewarding, and that brought everything in balance. Okay, now we jump to 2017, 8 years later. 8 years later, so last year in June, I was deployed again as a military gender advisor, but now in the mission in South Lebanon, UNIFIL, as Deirdre has been deployed. The first military gender advisor in the mission there. So I arrived there and I said, hello, I'm Ella, I'm the gender advisor. And they said, welcome. Oh, we're so happy to have you here. Gender is so important. Oh, you should teach us. Can you maybe train all the staff officers here? Oh, Ella, we should talk. Shall we drink tea? I was amazed. 8 years later, we have made steps. I knew that we had made steps, but I was positively surprised about how I was received. And you could see, so that tells that we're making progress. And I was... although you could see that many people, many of my military colleagues were already trained in gender in the pre-deployment training. Not all the nations are doing that, but more and more nations. And that is absolutely a step forward. And then in the mission, we train them again, and so we get more gender-sensitive troops with, hopefully, the effect that we integrate the gender perspective in our daily work. So, that was for me an amazing experience. And again, I was very positive, but at the same time, you need to keep on repeating in the military and also in this headquarters, hey, integrating gender is not only my responsibility, it's a responsibility of all of us. Okay. And then I think today at International Women's Day, I can say that I am proud of where we came. If you look at where we came from in the military and where we are now talking about gender awareness and how we are now actually in every mission, we train the troops. Yeah, in every mission, you see that there are gender advisors now who push things forward. And if you, for example, the force commander in UNIFIL, in this mission, he was so on board, you really didn't have to explain anything about how important it is to work from a gender perspective. And when I was walking on the base in UNIFIL at the headquarters, I often saw my colleagues, so from there or there, just sometimes even far away, and they were not saying, hey, Ella, but it was gender. And, you know, what else can a gender advisor wish for? And it sounds a bit hilarious, and it is a bit hilarious, and maybe they were a bit joking with me, but what for me the most important factor was behind this is that they were supporting me. And really, as a gender advisor, it is one of the best jobs I think you can have, but at the same time, you're always walking on a thin line. Because when you're pushing too much, you become the gender bitch. And then you lose the battle. And you don't want to lose the battle because still there's a world to win. So you make sure you find your allies, you keep your allies, and you become best friends with them. Now, let me take you back to 2009. I came back from the mission in Afghanistan. 5 months long, I had been fighting for gender in the mission. It was a good mission, but it was quite tough. I was out there in an unsafe and unsecure environment. And I came home and I thought, yes, I did it. But who was the hero? Who was the hero? Was it me? No, it was not me. It was my husband, because my husband took care of our 1.5-year-old daughter for 5 months. And everybody was saying to me, hey, Ella, you're back. Oh, isn't your husband amazing? Can't you believe it? He took care of her all by himself for 5 months. Oh, really? You should take a picture of him, put him in a golden frame and put it on the wall. And nobody was talking about the 25-year-old Italian au pair who I had arranged for him and who helped him out for these 5 months. And now, imagine, he had been the one who had been deployed. And he came back from the mission. And I was at home together with my daughter these 5 months. Who do you think would have been the hero?